Hello and welcome to Access Community Television. This episode, we bring you stories from within. We bring you good stories of mental wellness and cooperating with others. I'm Molly Caron.
Hi, I'm Narges Mowlaee, and we're also going to talk about Maladjusted, a new play by Theatre for Living, which tries to break the stigma around mental health by getting us all involved.
And Imtiaz Popat will bring in Azim and Roshme, who will tell us about the Muslim food bank and how the Islam principles are shared and brought to the community through empowering others.
We also cherish Carnegie Newsletter and Co-op Radio, two excellent local platforms for dynamics of life and struggles in our community.
We'll bring you a story of Bowen Island and how they're solving transportation problems. And one man has stepped up, Peter King, and he's taking people from downtown Bowen Island to downtown Vancouver on his bus.
Screens.
I just forgot my wallet, so I'll have to pay tomorrow.
Just leave your phone here,
sir. You're burning all
the- I'm looking into Wi-Fi for the bus, so.
You're providing free advertising to people?
On the inside, yeah.
Cool.
Last time's been 19 minutes.
31
people.
31 people.
6:30 run.
6:30 run. Oh, sad.
Morning, Peter.
How are you? This is a 6 GB data plan. It probably makes sense to
mentioning something to me about buses, that like there's some sort of mechanism that recognizes when a bus is coming to change the lights.
See, when you have the left turn lane here coming this way, when it finishes and there's a bus in the lane there, it sets off a priority light. These two buses get through before us. It's a great way of setting things up because it separates the cars. You can get three buses through. There they go. So you see the white bar above the red light there. And then they have access right to the front of the line. It's as good as it's going to get here.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever listened to Tesla?
Oh, is there, that's a Tesla in front of us? Oh, I love that.
The sun is here.
Ooh.
They open up the hatchback and just...
to go to Toronto.
All right.
Thanks, Peter.
You're serious?
Awesome.
Have a great trip.
Thanks.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
See you. Bye-bye.
See you this evening, Peter.
You betcha. Bye-bye. Now. There we go.
Well, the TransLink referendum has begun. The results are expected in May. The Bowen Island ferry refit should be completed in May as well. Now, that TransLink bus transfer should get you from downtown Vancouver to Bowen Island. Peter King will honor that.
Next, we have the founders of Muslim Food Bank here with us. It is a non-for-profit not only catering to food and dietary needs, but also offering services such as counseling for addiction and mental health, mentorship, education, career guidance, and more. Let's hear about it.
Hi, this is Imtiaz Popat, and joining me is Azim Dahya and Roshme Azeez from the Muslim Food Bank. Assalamu alaikum to both of you.
Wa alaikum salam.
So, Brother Azeez, you were one of the founders of the Muslim Food Bank. Tell us how you started and what was your inspiration? Why did you start the Muslim Food Bank?
I was actually, when I went to volunteer at the Saraya Food Bank, and actually some of us, it was very sad to see the poverty that is prevalent in the society, mm-hmm. Food insecurity. Mm-hmm. And our faith teaches us to feed the needy, the orphans and the captives, you know, and not expecting any thanks from them and not having any expectation of anything. So it's part of our faith and it's part of the passion that we had to serve the community, to give back to this Canadian community that has given us so many resources.
I guess Muslims have specific dietary needs, so the regular food bank is not serving that need. That's why there was a need for a Muslim food bank.
That's correct. We saw that there was an opportunity where some of the people could not eat most of the food that were given by the local food banks, the vegans and those who had religious dietary needs. So then we thought that we would do something about it.
So, Roshme, tell me, what does distribution look like in a regular food bank?
So at a regular food bank day, the volunteers show up around 7:30 in the morning on a Saturday. So we serve on the first and third Saturday of every month. So once the volunteers come in, they just get to work. Each one takes on a different role. So we have the new registrants, the regular clients coming in, and then we have different departments where there's packing of flour, the sugar, the hamper distribution, then there's the meat to be distributed. Mm-hmm. So we just organize ourselves, we have team leaders, and then they just get to work.
And all the meat is halal, right?
All the meat is halal,
that's
yes.
Correct.
Then by 8:30, the customers come in, and once we register them, we give them numbers, and they go and pick up their hampers. And we also have a team that provides breakfast. So every Saturday, their team comes in with hot breakfast. They have sandwiches, there's tea, coffee. So customers, there's the volunteers, the customers, everybody receives breakfast there. But on a cold day, on a rainy day, there's no difference.
And how long has this been going on for?
This is our fifth year, and the good thing is we not only want to just give them the basic needs, we have come up with a holistic approach where we help them to be self-reliant by providing them with inspiration, resources, and access to affordable education. And that is why we have come up with the Aspire program that has multiple level of interventions, and that helps all this. So we want to break the cycle of poverty and get these people to be progressive and productive members of the Canadian society.
So because of the engagement you have with their clients, you're now actually doing counseling and casework and settlement work as well.
Yes.
And you just don't help Muslims. You also come to Oppenheimer Park once a month on the third Saturday to feed the hungry there too.
That's correct. So we have a group going down every month to Oppenheimer Park, and we feed 300 to 400 homeless people. And as I said, some of the dietary restrictions are vegan,
yeah.
Not necessarily Muslims. So we have our clients, some of them are non-Muslims.
Mm, mashallah. So you have a fundraiser coming up on the 28th. Where is that going to be? And it's to help promote the work of the food bank?
That's correct. Because we run all this program with the Aspire Training Institute, training the caseworkers. We have counselors that supervise these caseworkers. We need funding and for the food and everything. So we have a major fundraising we do once a year, and it's coming on March 28th. It's at the Pyle Center and a Royal Banquet Hall. And for people who want to buy tickets, they can actually go online at muslimfoodbank.com and they can purchase the tickets there.
It's only $25,
yes, $25
for a fundraiser.
Yes.
You know, $25 and you get the food and you're helping a good cause. So
yes,
it's definitely a good cause. And people should come and celebrate the 5th anniversary of the Muslim Food Bank, which is now branched out. It's not just a food bank.
No.
It actually has the whole project, the Aspire training.
Yes.
And coming to the Downtown Eastside every month, people who want to volunteer, they can contact you.
We are always open to volunteers.
And to help in the food bank and also to do casework and counseling, everything.
We have free training programs through the Aspire Training Institute, and they can register online and attend the courses, get certified, and then support wherever they can.
So we train people to help everybody. So the aim is that we want people to get engaged in helping other people, and they can have the same passion as we have and get the satisfaction of helping people, because the satisfaction, that the happiness we get out of that, is there is no monetary amount for that.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being here. And this is Imtiaz Popat signing off for Access Community Television, promoting our friends and our community.
Well, hello, I'm Molly Caron, and I'm here with Chris Hilliker, who has taken the science of appliance into a new and moral direction. He's here with me to talk about washing machines, refrigerators, and their true value. Welcome to Access TV.
Thank you.
So how long have you been studying appliances, Chris?
Basically all my life. Ah. I've repaired thousands and thousands of machines.
And when did you become a business and take it seriously? And
I first opened Cambie Appliance in 2009.
Okay, awesome. What have you noticed as time goes on? Have you made observations about newer models and compared them to older models?
Absolutely. I've noticed the quality and the longevity drop dramatically in the time that I've been in the field. And the time previous, I was lucky to have a very nice mentor in the business, and he'd been in appliance repair for about 30 years.
Wow.
And he told me when I started that I should expect to see clients maybe 5 or 10 years between visits. And now I find that I'm having to go and see people every 1 or 2 years. And sometimes I have to go and see people more than once a year. But that's usually when they've either purchased a new place that has all new appliances, or they've renovated and replaced all the appliances at once. They all kind of seem to hit a point in their life where they need repair. So I'll go and fix the oven,
wow,
and then I'll be back in less than a year to fix the fridge or the dishwasher and so on.
Now, how do you know that doesn't reflect on your work? How do you know that that's about the machine?
Well, because I'll be back to fix a totally different machine. So I'll get their fridge fixed and then it'll go on for years, but it sort of hits like an age, you know,
yeah,
like around age 7 or 8 or 9, where all these machines, no matter what kind of machine they are, it's almost like, you know, they're triggered to have something go wrong.
Wow. So in my case, I have a stacking washing machine and dryer that I bought secondhand from Beeline Appliance about 5 years ago, and I've never had to have it serviced. I wonder why that is.
How old is this machine?
I think it's about 15 years old.
That's why.
Maybe older.
Yeah. Back in the day, things were made very, very solid. They would make the chassis or the body structure able to last decades.
Okay.
So nowadays, they put in integral parts that they expect to fail within about 7 years. For example, front load washing machines often have parts that corrode in detergent and water.
Mm.
Integral parts, so without them you can't use the machine. And then the price to repair those parts costs about the same as buying a new one. So then people are forced into this horrible choice.
Yeah.
Where they have to decide whether to spend the price of a new one to keep the old one from the landfill, or just abandon it and buy a new one.
Wow. It almost sounds like planned obsolescence. Shame. It's like it's almost planned for the company to make more money by not making it last.
Yeah. Intent is always the hardest thing to prove. But if you're using parts that corrode in detergent and water, then that's sort of bizarre. The other thing is I'll see that they'll have a lot of proprietary electronics in the machines. So you can only get those electronics from the manufacturer. Right. And if they ever decide to stop making those parts, then you have no choice. You're forced to buy a new one.
And that has a huge impact on the planet.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And the mining and the disposal and everything that is involved with an appliance. I'm really glad you're joining us on Access TV. You'll be back, and I'm wanting to know from you next time is, how do I know when an appliance is worth keeping or not?
That's a really good question.
Old is gold and new is not necessarily better. We will speak more about this. We've been learning about appliances on Access TV. I'm Molly Caron, and the learning continues.
Chris Hilliker would be back with us for another appliance break on April 12th. Get in touch with him and ask your questions directly on his Facebook page, Cambie Appliances and Refrigeration. Maybe next time on Access TV, he will be answering your question.
Truth in media keeps the oppression away, and that's what Co-op Radio has done for me and many others. Next up, we're going to meet some of the personalities behind the microphone. Here they are on Access TV. It takes a village.
As well, Scarlett is my co-pilot, and she has got Mastermind out. It's a great radio game. And I'm Molly, Molly Caron, mama and volunteer collaborator of this experiment that we call It Takes a Village, where we parent on the air. The reason I got involved so heavily with Co-op Radio is there were really no barriers for me as a mom. I could bring my newborn baby and nurse her and broadcast simultaneously. Hi!
What's up, baby? I'm going to do something.
Yes, it does, Raffi. It takes a village. It also takes a few poets, some directors, some performers, and a whole bunch of creative, resourceful thinking. And let's get our guest comfortable. Excuse me. I'll be right back.
I am ready.
Oh, did you really? Oh, I loved it. I took 2 5-year-olds.
And
they loved it. They were standing up in the front row.
Oh, fantastic.
Scarlett, this is our guest.
Am I here?
Yeah, this is your voice. If you haven't heard enough of your voice already.
I don't know.
Put the earphones on. Now, can I call you a performer, director, and you started as an actor, you're turning into a director now.
Yeah, I would consider myself mostly an actor, theater educator, director.
That was an abrupt ending. That was you. You are what you is, which isn't exactly a grammatically correct sentence, but we're going to forgive Frank Zappa because he's just got such a free-form way of thinking and making music. I'm Molly Caron. I'm here on It Takes a Village with our guest, Mike Stack. Welcome to the public airwaves.
Molly.
Which is a good name because, you know, Shakespeare can be painful. You're putting that all together and adding some hormones.
Yes.
Excuse me for a minute while I parrot.
That's okay.
Scarlett, those keys are too loud for the radio. Please. Okay. We're here.
No, if you don't give me Shakespeare till I'm in grade 10, I don't care about it. If I haven't had a real exposure to poetry and storytelling in a positive way before that time, I'm not suddenly going to leap on board late in high school.
We're going to take a break. I'm speaking with Mike Stack, who is the writer. Creator, the architect, perhaps?
The writer.
The writer.
Adapter, maybe?
Yes. The DJ of the words of Shakespeare himself.
The show.
I'm George Bowering. Congratulations to Co-op Radio for 40 years of great listening.
I'm Gennarji O'Sullivan, and this is Access TV. Today, we're celebrating Co-op Radio, 40 years of community radio. It's a non-commercial and listener-supported radio station located currently at 2014 Wall Street. We have 4 programmers here with us today. We're going to start off with Pam Bentley, who is the Director of Member Services and does a show called Wax Poetic. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Gennarji.
Yeah, nice nice to see you.
Yeah.
And we also have Gwendolyn Reichman. She does a show and is one of the longest programmers. It's called In the Pines. And Giuseppe Gonchi.
Yes.
He's one of the newest programs with his co-host Francis Stone, and their show is called Talk Recovery. It's an interesting day, and so glad to have you here. Let's start off with you.
What shows you do? What shows do you do on Co-op?
What show do I do? I do four shows at Co-op Radio. One, Spirit Whispers, on Monday between 1 and 2:30. It's a supports reconciliation. Tuesday, Snowiles, and that's a language and cultural program. And Wednesday night, Late Night with Savages and Kahaya FM. We report the news every Thursday between 5 o'clock and 6. I have other co-hosts that work with me as well.
Cool.
Yeah, thanks, Pam.
Yeah, that's one of the things I love about Co-op Radio is that there's more Indigenous programming than anywhere else in Vancouver. Mm-hmm. And even though we're working with a lot fewer resources than all the other radio programs, because we're an independent station, unlike campus radios, we don't get the student fees money. We are not supported by an institution. We're all member-owned. That's where the co-op part comes in. And that's where my job comes in as a director of member services. I get members for the station, and I provide services for the members who are already there, who, and all our programmers are volunteers, as you know, and they're also members. You have to be a member in order to get on air. And the big exciting thing about this year in 2015 is Co-op Radio is 40 years old.
Nice.
Yeah.
So we're getting old.
I know.
So they almost went over the hill.
Yeah. Oh, come on now. I'm older than 40. So Co-op Radio went on air on April 15th, 1975. They got their license from CRTC a little bit earlier than that, but on air. That was the first day.
Sorry. Vancouver Co-op Radio is at 100.5 FM CFRO, yes. But it used to be 102.7 FM.
That's right. And a lot of our archival photos that we've been pulling out to get ready for all the celebrations that we're doing around our 40th will show 102.7 in the background. And so, yeah, we've switched to 100.5, but it's still the same great station.
And we've also relocated a few times. We used to be located at Pigeon Park to begin with, and then we moved up a block to 360 Columbia Street, and then over to Wall Street 2014, and then this year we'll be moving on back over to 360 Columbia Street.
That's right, because we only moved temporarily to Wall Street while the building at Columbia Street is being renovated.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so we'll be moving back in December of 2015, but that's just one of the challenges that we handle, and we keep going, and we're having a celebration on April 17th at the Wise Hall for former programmers, current programmers, listeners, members, former guests, and everybody's invited.
Okay, we'll be there, and so will you. Gwendolyn, let's talk about you. You're one of the longest programmers at Co-op Radio?
I guess. I mean, I've been programming since for about 28 years, and it's easy for me to tell that because my daughter was an infant when I first started volunteering at on the Roots Music Show. When I first started, it was called Radio Ranch, and it focuses primarily on bluegrass and old-time music, string band music. Mm-hmm. There's a big community of musicians and aficionados within the Lower Mainland, and down into Washington State. And I guess now that we're on the World Wide Web, I get feedback from pretty much all over. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. People will email or phone
up. You can also check out our archives at www.coopradio.org. Go to programming scheduling, and there we are in the archives, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. So your show is on what day and what time?
On Sundays from 2:30 until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm just one of five hosts. Our program is run by a collective of volunteers who operate as well as host. So there's five other individuals. We each take a Sunday and host. My current Sunday is the first Sunday of the month. And we have live guests sometimes, and a lot of local information about what's happening in the music scene so that people can get connected with string band music.
So how can people contact you if they'd like to be a guest on your show?
Well, probably the best way would be through the website, cooperadio.org, in the Pines, or
call down when we're on the air, which is always fun. I love having people
call
in. It's very exciting because we're like a real person on the end. So when you hear the music that's happening in the conversation, when you call up, it's actually me who answers the phone.
All right, moving on to Talk Recovery, which airs every Thursday between 12 and 1. We have Giuseppe Ganci as well as Francis Stone, his co-host. Yes. Tell us all about the program.
Well, there's three co-hosts. Missing here is Darren Gaylor. Talk Recovery is every Thursday at noon till 1. And we decided to bring recovery and addiction issues on air in a city that is, you know, heavily involved in the addiction world with the Downtown Eastside. We wanted to show a different side and talk about the pathways to recovery.
Awesome. And so tell us what motivated you to do your programming at Co-op Radio, Francis?
Well, I had written a book about my own journey of recovery and how I got sober.
And what was it called?
A Reflection of Love, A Different Kind of Love Story. Mm-hmm. And there was no platform to bring the story to. So I started getting involved in Vancouver Co-op Radio, and then I approached Leela, the program coordinator, with the show idea. Yeah. She was really interested in it, but she said I needed to find people to do it with. So yeah. Then I started seeking out people, and I found Giuseppe, which was a rare find because he's super organized and awesome.
Yeah. Did it make a big difference to the community at large, do you think?
Oh, yes. We get many people when we're talking to friends and so forth. They're like, you know, I heard the show about addiction in the workplace, or I heard the show about Bandu, or I heard the show about, you know, how safe is the safe injection site, and it just brings a different point of view.
So how do people contact you if they want to be a part of your show?
We have many channels. You can contact us through Facebook and Twitter. Our website is talkrecoveryvancouver.com, and that links you to Co-op Radio's archives, and it links you to all the social media. So nice. If you want to be our guest, contact us.
Yes. My name is Gennady O'Sullivan. Thank you, people, for connecting with us at Access TVD, from community to community, Vancouver's Community Radio, Co-op Radio. You can call them at 604-684-8494 or 604-684-7561.
Wow, cooperating for 40 years and celebrating on the 15th of April at the Wise Hall should be an interesting mix and mingle of radio geeks and beyond.
Theatre for Living's current project, Maladjusted, is all about humanizing mental health problems. Here's Molly Caron with David Ng in conversation about empowering issues that are hard to talk about.
My name is Sam Bob. My traditional name is Tulkwitmult. I'm from Snow Nose First Nations. I play Frank, who is the recovery house manager.
I told you, man, you saw what happened. I couldn't be in that room with seven other guys without my meds.
Man, everybody goes through that. Fucking touch me, man.
As a former residential school survivor and as a person that's dealt with the addiction issues and seeing it firsthand in our families and our communities, I'm happy to try and be more of a help to the solution. Mental health is like not so much to be normal, it's just to be who you really are, being in touch with all the good things in life. We have our longhouses, our dances, our language. We really need to recognize the power of those things and the power of all the traditional medicines that we bring in that could help somebody that's in crisis.
Hello, I'm here with David Ng, who is the outreach coordinator for Theater for Living, and they are currently mid-tour with the production of Maladjusted, which has left Alberta. It's in BC, and they're coming our way. And we just saw a short clip. Can you tell us about what we just saw?
Yeah, so that clip was of Sam Bob, who plays Frank in Maladjusted. Frank is the recovery house manager. Sam Bob is just sharing his story about how he got involved, or his relationship with mental health and with Maladjusted. Maladjusted is created and performed by patients and caregivers, mm-hmm. and Sam Bob actually created the role of Frank, who is a recovery house manager. He has some stories around being in a recovery house.
Now, Theatre for Living is an evolution of Theatre of the Oppressed, mm-hmm. and let's talk a little bit about what that evolution is. What's the difference between Theater of the Oppressed and Theater for Living?
Yeah, so there are many similarities. I mean, David Diamond, who founded Theater for Living, was a very good friend of Augusta Boal, who founded Theater of the Oppressed. I guess sort of the main differences, if you will, or departures that Theater for Living takes is Theater of the Oppressed takes a little bit more of a binary model. Mm-hmm. And so in traditional Theater of the Oppressed, you have the oppressed sort of learning to break oppression, whereas Theater for Living takes a more systemic look at things.
Looks at everybody's role in...
Yeah, and really honors all the sides of the story, not to, you know, validate the actions of the oppressor,
right.
But to also, you know, understand that these people don't just come out of space. We grow right. them from our communities, and if we're going to, you know, create social change, we have to honor their story as well.
Right. And that takes the fear out of it, out of the equation, so that if you're understanding them, mm-hmm. then they're not the other.
Exactly, yeah.
All right, now this topic of maladjusted is about mental health, mm-hmm. and there is a lot of fear, stigma, and judgment around that. Mm-hmm. And it's universal, really. In every community, we are faced with mm-hmm. mental illness.
Yeah.
How, as the outreach coordinator, are you approaching communities and bringing people together?
Yeah, well, one of the beautiful things about maladjusted is that it talks about many different layers of the mental health system. It's not, you know, it's about patients, caregivers, but it also, I think, one of the most beautiful parts is that it actually illuminates how all of us are you know, trying to adjust to this maladjusted mental mm-hmm. health system. And so even though, you know, we may not have a diagnosis of mental health, we all may know someone who is struggling through, mm-hmm. going through a hard time. You know, we may have to go through the medical system, which is, of course, attached to the mental health system.
Right.
And yeah, so we're all kind of a part of that.
And so you're bringing the community in and inviting mm-hmm. the play into people's lives. Now, I've been to some Theater for Living productions, and I know that when you go, the play transpires and it ends, and then it goes again, and the audience is invited to engage.
Yeah, to offer interventions or solutions. So basically what happens in Maladjusted weaves together three storylines. So the first one is of a young woman whose best friend has recently committed suicide. She's really sad.
Yeah.
And being a teenager, she you know, is at war with her mother, and her mother's also going through some other stuff as well.
Yeah.
Her mother's trying to fix her, and so she takes her to a psychologist, who takes her to a psychiatrist, who within 15 minutes diagnoses her with bipolar. So again, created and performed by patients and caregivers, this story comes from a lived experience.
Mm-hmm.
The second storyline is of a homeless man who is on anxiety medication. He needs his anxiety medication.
Mm-hmm.
His social worker finds him a room.
Yeah.
But it's the only room that's available in the community, and it's in an addictions recovery facility. And so one of the house rules is that they have to confiscate his medication when they check him in.
Oh, dear.
And so he goes through some struggles there, because yeah. he gets checked in on a Friday, and the house doctor doesn't come in until Monday.
Right.
The third storyline is of the service providers who, you know, and I think this is really important. Maladjusted is not about demonizing service providers, you know.
No.
And I think Maladjusted does a really good job of illuminating the fact that they went to med school wanting to help people, really wanting to give good care.
Yeah.
But because of the mechanization of the system, are making poor decisions. And so the play weaves together these three storylines. It ends on a crisis, basically posing a question to the audience, you know, how can we create more human-centered care?
Okay.
And then the play runs through a second time, and then in the second time, the audience is invited to stop the play at any time to offer interventions or solutions. So in that way, it's a really great opportunity for a really rich dialogue about
yeah.
mental health,
yeah.
and yeah, we're hoping that people will come and participate.
It's such a valuable tool, theater. Mm-hmm. Well, we can see Maladjusted at the Fire Hall Theater running from March 20th to March 28th, and Theater for Living is online. Mm-hmm. And David Ng, it's a pleasure to meet you and know
Thank
that
you.
You're out there making communities get together and face the elephant in the room.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
This shrine is so important because in 1981, Vi's Chicken and Steak Inn burned to the ground. It was wood. This building stands because it's brick. Is it because it's brick, or is it divine intervention from Jimmy himself? Her name was Vi Moore, and she was famous for hiring relatives. Well, first start Vi's Chicken and Steak Inn was built in 1950. It was a taste of the southern style of Afro-American cooking, the chicken shack, if you will. And that building stayed here till 1976, till Vi passed away. After the breadwinner and father Ross passed away in 1934, poor Nora, Zenora is her name, but Grandma Nora didn't know what to do. She began working at Vi's Chicken and Steak Inn. Now, Jimmy's famous for doing the Star Spangled Banner. Yesterday was Canada Day, so I was playing. And that building was a kitchen and storage area. And after Vice would close, Jimmy was a kid, you know, so he would practice here, rehearse. He joined the Army in 1960, lasted till 61, 62. It was a real culture shock for him because he's from Seattle. And his youth and upbringing was Seattle, Vancouver. And we're pretty liberal over here. Then he joins the military, anything but liberal. And then after all that excitement, he met some Army buddies who could play instruments. Billy Cox, who went on to play bass with him in a band of gypsies. They toured what they called the Chitlin Circuit. Jimmy was trained, basic training in California at Fort Ord. And then he went to Kentucky. Can't remember offhand the base or location. But when he went to Kentucky, all of a sudden he's told where he can go, where he can't go. You can't eat here, can't eat there. Oh my God, who's in your band? And he didn't feel that great about that. His first guitar was a ukulele with one string. Later on, he got all the strings for the ukulele. Later on, he got a guitar and put all the strings on it. And he was hearing other people playing electric guitar, and he wanted to play so bad. He got a pickup, and his brother and he, they never had an amp, but they fooled around with the family stereo and plugged the pickup into the family stereo, and he was getting distortion, not the cool distortion we have today, but... And, you know, Leon Hendrix wrote a book called A Brother's Story, and I loved it because how honest can you get? Oh, we plugged that pickup into the family stereo. I guess I was his first guitar tech. And unfortunately, Vise is gone. However, the story remains, and this storage room and kitchen area remains. This is the hub of the Afro-Canadian neighborhood of Hogan's Alley. And if you wanted, many people didn't come here because of the neighborhood. However, Billie Holiday would come here. Duke Ellington would come here. Ray Charles, the Afro-American artists, when they performed in Vancouver, whether it was the Commodore, the Penthouse, or P&E, Pacific Coliseum, they came here for some southern home cooking.
March 21st is the 8th annual Community March Against Racism, starting at Clark Park. Our next segment, we have Wendy Peterson back to fill us in with Gunarji O'Sullivan on the hot topics.
Hello, my name is Wendy Peterson. I'm here with Gunarji O'Sullivan for Hot Topics on Access TV. So, Gunarji, tell me about the Capilano Herbal Apothecary. What is this store that's opening up close to the downtown east side?
Well, it's medicinal tea. That's what it is. And it's a Azeez initiative. She's a medicine woman from the Squamish Nation. Check it out.
Yeah, I think they're opening on March 20th. Mm-hmm. And it's on Powell Street, 1875 Powell. And we'll put up the website address. I think it's thecapilano.com.
Uh-huh. So I can't wait, because that's just a hop, skip, and a jump away from Co-op Radio.
So what else?
Yeah, what about the walk to raise welfare rates? Oh, what is that all about?
Yeah, well, we want all our listeners and viewers to know that on Tuesday, March 31st, there's going to be a walk to raise welfare rates. Mm-hmm. It leaves Carnegie at 11 a.m.
And there's been 8 years with no welfare rate raise in the province, which is shocking because people are living in destitution and poverty.
The cost of living keeps going up.
Yeah, so it's going to be a walk to the BC government buildings.
Okay.
So we got to keep get everybody there.
Keep on walking.
And then tell us about the Aboriginal Youth Mountain Bike Project.
Well, that is interesting because they want to encourage healthy living through and living with nature through mountain biking. And you can find that more about that on the Indiegogo. It's called Aboriginal Youth Mountain Biking.
That sounds like a good project too.
Good project. They want to raise $5,000. They've only raised $2,520.
Wow.
Yes. Now let's move on to United for Chinatown.
Yeah, I don't know if people heard, but there's quite a movement happening in Chinatown right now around gentrification.
Uh-huh.
So on March 3rd, they went to City Hall, a huge group of people. I think there was 150, many Chinese seniors, with a petition for a 1,400-person petition to stop condo development. They're calling for a moratorium on condos in Chinatown because Chinatown's changing so quickly and they're losing their stores, the rents are going up, and there's no new seniors housing coming. There was a study that says that seniors need 3,600 units of housing in the next few years. That's Chinese language for Chinese seniors who don't speak English.
Mm.
So we got to pay attention to that issue. What about the powwow celebration, the UBC powwow celebration? Yeah. Can you tell us about
sure
that?
Sure can. You know, that's happening on April the 4th, 2015 at the War Memorial Gym. Go powwow with the people at UBC celebration at the War Memorial Gym. Okay, let's follow up with the Right to Remain exhibition.
Yeah, the Right to Remain, it's on at the Gallery Gachet. It's a pretty cool research project. It's an art show, ends on April 12th. The Gallery Gachet is on Cordova Street in the Downtown Eastside, and it's a dialogue about human rights. And it's been led by the Japanese-Canadian community that was uprooted during the war with the internment camps from the Downtown Eastside. They're leading the project along with Aboriginal folks and Chinese folks and others who have faced discrimination in that neighborhood. So it's an art show about that topic. It's really great.
Awesome initiative.
And yeah.
What about the big chemical spill?
Yes, we wanted to talk about this. Both Gennardi and I live in the Downtown Eastside and we're affected by that chemical spill.
Yeah.
And we were just saying how much of a shame it is that people who were on the street didn't get noticed that it was happening.
Mm-hmm. Where do they go?
Where do they go?
When they're homeless and have nowhere to go to hide from this risk, you know, like the chemical spill.
So thanks a lot for watching Hot Topics. We'll be here again with you on Access Television.
Yes.
That's what we'll celebrate. We're going to celebrate that we're still here as Indigenous nations, Indigenous peoples, with that inherent right to self-determination, because we have our own lands, our own languages, our own laws, our own identifiable customs, forms of government, our own peoples. The inherent right to self-determination. So we will celebrate that we've survived. That's what we'll celebrate. That's what we're going to hold our hands up to and celebrate. We're still here. And we're more now than just survivors of residential schools. We're going to be thrivers. We're going to be thrivers, and that's how we're going to keep building, getting stronger. That service is going to get stronger, free from alcohol and drugs, because that's the way we're going to rebuild our nations. That's what we'll celebrate in 2017. That's what we're going to hang on to.
I'm Gennardi O'Sullivan with Gary Over and Paula Fairweather. We're going to talk first about the residential school demolition ceremony that happened on February the 18th. I went as a residential school survivor and an intergenerational survivor to St. Michael's. Gary went there in support of me and as a witness.
Yeah, it was quite the interesting trip that we had. The weather wasn't too bad. Had a little bit of wind, but the day of the ceremony was actually it was all right, and there was a really good turnout.
Yeah, there were about 500 or 600 people there, all at the beginning of the day, watching and waiting for the demolition to begin, right?
Yeah, and I got, I was on a camera and I did a lot of filming and we got lots of different angles. I got to witness some of the prayers and the pain of the memories of a lot of the survivors. And, even at that point, I would even have said prayers for them. I threw stones at the school window for them, because some of them weren't able to, throw a stone, so I would, throw it for them, so.
Yeah, that was kind of interesting. Throughout the morning, there were speeches by the Chief Deborah Hannus. Alex Nelson was one of the MCs. We got to see a lot of people who were in deep, deep grief. You'll see pictures of Ruby Dawson and the Chief, the Namgis Chief, and also Bob Chamberlain, who is from Kinkum Inlet. But as the day went on, we moved on to the ceremony after the demolition, after they took the excavator and began to take the entrance of the residential school down. We decided we had to move forward. We went back to the big house and we began a celebration with a brushing off ceremony. People like Perry Bellegarde, the national chief, spoke about the importance of like sobriety, cleanliness, and rising above the atrocities. Bob Chamberlain spoke and so did Jody Wilson. Very inspirational and a great example of how to move forward. Now, speaking of which, the Bill Reed Gallery is facilitating rising above the atrocities that happened to residential school by bringing back the language and the culture through art. There was a big feast that happened at the Longhouse.
At UBC, yes, at the UBC. First Nations House of Learning on Monday night, uh-huh. Just 2 days before we opened the exhibition at the Bill Reed Gallery. And yeah. The exhibition, the box of treasures, gifts from the supernatural, it was spearheaded really by Bo Dick. Mm-hmm. Our curator, Kuiwa Jones, worked very closely with Bo Dick over a long period of time to bring this exhibition to the gallery.
And they began with the feast at the Longhouse,
yes.
Which is the proper way to celebrate something that is going to be happening, something important. And this important event was the Box of Treasures, gifts from the supernatural. They had a feast there. They introduced the coppers and the gifts of the treasure box that had been in Bo Dick's family and Bobby Joseph's family for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. They showed the treasure box, a couple of the masks, the wolf mask, and another mask.
Yes, that's right. And they also danced some of the Atlakima masks from the creatures of the forest.
Yes.
And they danced some other articulated masks as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they must have danced about 10 masks.
10 masks. It's a great way to witness events, bringing the camera in and recording it for the people and bringing it back to people like here, our audience at Access TV. So that was an interesting night and an interesting way to celebrate the Box of Treasures. And let's talk about the opening. Do you want to do that?
Absolutely.
Sure. Yeah, it was fun, eh?
Yeah.
So.
It was packed. We had over 300 people there, and it was an exceptional evening, and great community support, great cultural support. And I just want to mention the mission of the Bill Reed Gallery is to reveal the vital and diverse Indigenous cultures of the Northwest Coast through not only Bill Reed's works, but exceptional featured exhibitions. And the Box of Treasures is that. It is really amazing to see such incredible ceremonial masks in a gallery setting,
something
which
that
is very
was
unusual.
Outlawed years ago.
Absolutely.
And now here we are displaying them.
Displaying them and displaying them to the big public. It's absolutely incredible to see them in that context. And they're not meant to be hung on a wall, as you of course know. They are meant to be danced. So we have a number of masks, ceremonial masks and regalia that are on display for a 5-month period in the gallery. And it's important to know that those masks are meant really, are working masks, if you will. Mm-hmm. Correct?
Yeah, correct. Yeah. They are. They use them to dance, in ceremony, to tell stories of the past that, you know, that have even meanings to this day, right? So, and it's something that's really culturally important.
And it's also very educational, because we're going into a very busy time at the gallery. We're going into the visitor season. And so through March through September, we'll have a number of people coming to the gallery that may not have any awareness of this. So it's a wonderful celebration and educational opportunity for a lot of people.
And you know what's important is that not only non-Aboriginal people don't know about these ceremonial masks and the origins of the mask, but also First Nations people who have been displaced through the residential school era, foster care and adoption, also don't know. So this is a great educational tool, and thank you for facilitating the revitalization of our language and culture. It's very meaningful, and it will make a huge difference to our community at large.
And I want to also say it's a privilege to have this show in the gallery, and there were a lot of permissions that were required in order to do so, and we think it's an absolute honor to
have. So you followed protocol to a T.
We did, absolutely. Awesome. And I also want to mention, Bo Dick was very, very instrumental to this happening, but he also credits his Kikinui, the skilled carvers.
Skilled carvers?
Exactly. And many of these masks were creative collaborations.
All right. Thank you for joining us on Access TV. Thank you, Gary Over and Paula Fairweather. It's been a pleasure. It really has.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Well, it's a new day when such an institution of oppression comes down. And it's a new day when we all have cultural sensitivity to our past.
Next on Access TV, we're honoring the Carnegie Newsletter, one of the most read and well-respected publications in downtown Eastside. In the studio is Paul Taylor, the editor, telling us about the challenges and successes along the way in an interview with Sid Tan.
Hello and welcome to Access Community Television, shamelessly promoting our friends and community. And with me today is Paul Taylor, editor of the Carnegie Newsletter for almost 30 years, doing it as a volunteer. Terrific work, Paul. Thanks for being on the show to talk about the newsletter.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Almost 30 years now as editing. There must have been some high points and there must have been some low points. I just want to ask you, what are some of the high points for you, Paul?
The high points are talking about issues that really, really matter to people in the neighborhood. Best example is the murdered and missing women. The Carnegie paper, people began to write about this strange, terrible thing that was happening almost 2 years before anybody else. Other people have written stuff that have gone on to publish their own books. Sandy Cameron, a really good writer and a historian of the downtown, he's had his work picked up by national publications. Bud Osborne was the poet emeritus, the poet laureate of the Downtown Eastside. When he first got here, he was a heroin addict. And when I first printed some of his work, he was amazed that people actually accepted him for who he was. And he went from there to be a community activist for years.
I'm a regular reader of the Carnegie Newsletter. I picked it up. I've been reading it, as I said, for almost 30 years. Mm-hmm. What I really liked is, as you say, the new people, and now it's still continuing, right? There are writers that are getting published in there for the first time, and mm-hmm. it's really quite heartening to see. I was just wondering what some of the low points are, Paul.
Well, the low points are when certain people of vested interests get really angry about what's being written and try to kill the paper. Since 2008, one of the major problems has been raising enough money to pay for the printing. That's the only cost that we have. Some office supplies and to get food for volunteers. But the money is just dried up, or people can't see why they should bother supporting the Carnegie paper.
Well, I guess we'll do a shameless plug right now, and I know that the Carnegie Newsletter is at www.carnegienewsletter.org, and I know that on the top bar there's a donate button.
Oh, that's right. That's the best way for people to do it online. People can drop in with a check, with cash. Any amount helps, but the more people can help, it's the better it is, because we try and have 23 issues a year. There's more than enough content, and being that this is the poorest postal code in Canada, keeping the paper going for this long, it's been our community effort for sure.
Well, for me, to me, the Carnegie newsletter is almost the epitome of what a newsletter should do. You inform the community. Mm-hmm. It's done by the community. People come in and contribute to it, and I know that it's a very effective in getting out to the community. And now that you have the online version of it, which can be taken, as we said, at www.carnegienewsletter.org. I'm just thinking about, beyond the fundraising, which you just had a fundraiser at the St. James Hall, and you raised a few dollars. How much more do you need? What's needed to get you through the year?
To get through the year, we need about $11,000 more. We raised $3,000 in one night, and in this area, that's good. And there were a lot of local people that came to that event. But the printing of the Carnegie paper costs about $13,000 a year. There's also a resource guide called Help in the Downtown Eastside that we've always raised money for outside the newsletter. There's $3,000 per update, and two per year would be great.
We've got to go pretty soon, Paul. Thanks for being with us. And www.carnegienewsletter.org. Hit the donation button.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. You've been watching Access Community Television. I've been here with Paul Taylor, the editor of the Carnegie Newsletter. And please donate. Give it a hand. Thank you for watching. Straight shooting and tight edits to you.
Well, as we conclude another episode of Access Community Television, we invite you to reach out and tell us your story. We have a volunteer crew ready to shine the light on you, and we are accessible at Access TV. I'm Molly Caron.
Thank you so much for watching. I'm Narges Mowlaee, and we'll be back with another episode on April 12th. And Chris Hilliker, our appliance guy, is going to be here with us for another appliance break. Thank you.
The Downtown Eastside's most widely read paper about the Downtown Eastside. Nothing else like it in the city. The longest survivor. What else is there? Deeply committed to the cause of our community. Fearless, entertaining, moving, adventuresome with the facts. Passionate, committed, a must-read. Consistency, issue after issue, and month after month, year after year, and decade after decade. Thanks to the commitment of the volunteer staff working with the Downtown Eastside, for the Downtown Eastside, and about the Downtown Eastside. It educates about the Downtown Eastside community. It advocates for issues and concerns of our community. It speaks our values to the larger city and beyond. A gold mine of writing, giving voice to the low-income community of the Downtown Eastside, informing, illuminating, opening our eyes to gentrification and displacement, opening our hearts to the conditions of the SROs and the need for affordable housing. Nothing like it at any other community center in this city. Participant-driven, anarchistic, produced with hours of volunteer work, represents what real democracy is. Not city-funded, not city propaganda, it's real. And suits have come up the stairwell to the Carnegie office, and Paul didn't give a S-H-I.